In July 2012, a North Korean girl group reportedly handpicked by Kim Jong-un himself, called Moranbong Band, debuted at a televised concert in Pyongyang, North Korea. With sequined mini-dresses and electric violins, they didn't appear so different than their pop culture peers in South Korea or the United States. Moranbong Band did seem quite different, however, from what we've come to expect of North Korean propaganda, such as the Unsung Heroes film series, which features U.S. defectors, military propaganda music, and the famed Ardirang mass games during which thousands of citizens perform acrobatics and choreographed dances with precision. Could Moranbong Band have a number one hit in the U.S.? Their southern counterparts have had some successes. Rain gained notoriety when he battled Stephen Colbert for the top spot on the Time 100 poll back in 2008, a battle he won. And the Wonder Girls were the first K-pop band to land on a U.S. Billboard music chart in 2009. And in May 2013, Psy took home the trophy for the top streaming song, video, for Gangnam Style, becoming the first South Korean to win a U.S. Billboard Music Award. The song, and worldwide phenomenon, had also reached the number 2 spot on the Billboard Hot 100 music chart in October of the previous year, losing out only to Maroon 5's One More Night. How is it that K-pop has been able to resonate with U.S. audiences, especially when Gangnam Style is performed primarily in Korean? Cultural hybridity theory posits that globalized U.S. media are absorbed by local cultures and then reflected in their own media. Consequently, K-pop doesn't seem quite so foreign, making it easier for U.S. audiences to consume and appreciate. Look at what we have here. South Korea's Wonder Girls paid homage to Motown girl groups such as the Marvelettes in their 2009 music video for Nobody. And then North Korea's Moranbong Band went on to emulate the Motown style with their sequined dresses and bodily postures during their July 2012 debut performance in Pyongyang, North Korea. Therefore, I conducted an ideological analysis of the U.S. print and online media coverage of the Moranbong Band debut to discover the dominant and muted ideologies embedded in the news reports to gauge this North Korean band's chances of breaking into the U.S. market and to assess the reasons behind my conclusions. This being the case, my first research question is, how do the U.S. media respond rhetorically to Moranbong Band's hybridity, and which ideologies are embedded in these responses? And my second is, how do these U.S. ideologies support or undermine the potentiality for Moranbong Band to resonate with U.S. audiences? Let's take a look at this headline from our friends over at Fox News. U.S. criticizes North Korea over unauthorized Disney display. Well, yes, the performance featured Disney tunes, clips from Disney feature films, and costume characters. But what of Moranbong Band itself? What of its costumes and its performance? There's no mention. But before you start picking on poor Fox News, let's take a look at what our liberal media had to say. Disney, Mystery Woman and Disney, and once again, Disney. These articles did at least mention the group of young women in short dresses playing violins, but all focused primarily on the very surprising appearance of Mickey Mouse. Let's look at the nature of the ideologies at play. All of these are news organizations or programs, but what they really do is sell advertising and/or underwriting. Each has to answer to its sponsors, boards of directors, shareholders, and/or governmental agents. News is just the packaging in which the sponsorships are presented to the public. That sounds horrible, doesn't it? Yet in the United States, we value our intellectual property rights. What's mine is mine. We are capitalists after all. For North Korea to blatantly violate Disney's right to profit by hosting an unauthorized and unlicensed Disney performance wounds not only Disney, but the entire free market system and the American way of life. The nature of the ideology is clearly a conflict between U.S. neoliberal capitalism and the debated but useful term of North Korean Juche socialism, which is often oversimplified as self-reliance, but which also includes anti-U.S. imperialism. In fact, North Korea and the U.S. don't even maintain diplomatic ties or a trade agreement. Nevertheless, the ideological conflict is presented to the mass U.S. audience as a righteous claim, because North Korea has clearly crossed a line by stealing what is most dear to us, a symbol of who we are as a people, as great as Old Glory itself, Mickey Mouse. Well, at least for what Mickey Mouse stands, U.S. neoliberal capitalism. For these reasons, I conclude that instead of accepting or celebrating the hybrid features of Moranbong Band's debut, such as the band members' short sequin dresses or even the appearance of the world's most famous mouse, the U.S. media worked to reinforce capitalistic ideologies and U.S. hegemony by claiming that Disney is ours, not theirs. I also conclude that even if U.S. audiences would have been open to Moranbong Band's cultural outputs, the potentiality of this band and of NK-pop overall was undermined by the U.S. media's obsession with North Korea's copyright infringements, accusing the country of having complete disregard of international law and making them out to be quite wacky as well. This fixation meant that the U.S. media missed the opportunity to recognize the significance of the cultural hybridity that was reflected in Moranbong's performance. Moranbong isn't so different from the Duntons, an American folk group lauded by David Hasselhoff during a broadcast of America's Got Talent as an example of what America's all about. When we miss such parallels and instead focus on the wackiness of the state, we are also prone to discount beautiful North Korean folk music and to dismiss authentic cultural expressions and examples of everyday lives that aren't so different from our own. I too wore a red scarf to school as part of my campfire uniform in the 1980s, after all. Why does any of this matter? In September 2013, Dr. Younghae Chi of Oxford University said that the North Korean military is having a difficult time convincing young recruits to hate North Korea's sworn enemies because these young people are addicted to South Korean and U.S. television dramas. As he noted, imagine you love your enemy's culture. What if Moranbong Band broke into the U.S. market? And what if Americans started to love North Korean pop culture? What if Moranbong was popular enough to win a U.S. Billboard Music Award? Would someone like George W. Bush still be able to convince us that North Korea is part of an axis of evil? Could we view the DPRK as our enemy? Moranbong Band, however, will only have a chance to win a U.S. Billboard Music Award when we give North Korea and its people a chance to demonstrate that there is more to North Korea than copyright infringements and nuclear threats, and more to North Korean culture than its government. Sadly, it seems that this time is not yet at hand. Thank you very much.